Ladies and gentlemen, and Isabel, sorry. Thank you all for coming, and hopefully that we will have a few other people joining us as the evening goes on. I'm not going to hold you up for very long, just to say I'm Tessa, I'm the General Manager of the Folkestone and Sports Centre Trust. Really, really pleased to have our speakers here tonight. Just a real quickie, if the alarm goes off, we're not expecting it to, so it means it is real. Really simple, fire doors there, out of onto the side and assemble in the car park. If we are out there on the chairs, then again, it's the fire door that side and one at the other side. We will get you out. Okay, so thank you very much. I'll hand over. Enjoy the presentation.
Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I know we've already met as you've come through the doors, but just to reiterate, my name's Carissa Newsome and I work for Shade Master. And the Shade Master is the company that manufactures the equipment that you see in the room next door. So my bit this evening is I'm not going to bore you too much, about 5 minutes just talking about Shade Master, a little bit about us as a company, and looking at power-assisted exercise and its origins and how it's evolved, and certainly looking at the rehab market that we're sort of penetrating today. So, In terms of origination, we started back in 1989. We're a UK manufacturer based in Huddersfield. So all of the equipment that you see next door and some of the newer equipment around the country is all designed and manufactured in glorious Yorkshire.
Yeah.
I have a very strong accent, so if there's anything, if I speak too fast or you can't understand me, please feel free to interrupt and say, oh, what are you talking about? We've got one sole owner, that's Howard Blackburn, and he is the chap. He has two brains working at the same time. He designs the equipment and also manages us as well, so he has a very tall task. In terms of our distribution, we do have a global distribution with significant approved distributors in USA, Australia and Norway, where we've seen a real surge over the last 18 months. We're also established in the leisure markets, such as here in Folkestone, within care homes, independent salons. But what we've seen most recently is a real trend, certainly in the last few years, of rehabilitation centres. So treating those with long-term conditions such as stroke, post-stroke, multiple sclerosis, fibromyalgia, and other long-term health conditions. From an R&D point of view, we're really committed to continuously improving our equipment. So much so that we actually set up a think tank a couple of years ago. That think tank consists of healthcare professionals, operators around the country that are actually operating toning suites in leisure centres, in rehab facilities. And the task of that R&D group is A, to improve accessibility of our equipment and reduce the barriers to those that want to exercise, and also working on accessories that help particularly people like Sarah with foot drop, and also those that have contractures as well, and other sort of debilitating functions. We've also worked very, very closely with Sheffield Hallam University, and I'm proud as punch to say that Rachel's work has now been published. So we'll make sure that you get a copy of that. It makes for a very good reading. And I know that Rachel's going to talk more about that after I've rambled on for a bit. We also have some of our equipment under observation at Castle Hill School, which is based in Huddersfield. That's a special educational needs school for children 3 to 19. And we've got that under observation with the cerebral palsy user group, and we've seen some very, very good results, certainly in strengthening and actually getting some movement of the core as well with the waist away power tone. We've also had design work through Leeds Metropolitan University, and also a great study from Oklahoma State University. In terms of recognitions, we were shortlisted for the Spark of Innovation Award with UK Active. That meant basically we target the 88% of the population that don't go to a gym, not the 12% that have headphones in, looking quite fit. We're not bothered about that, we're bothered about the 88%. So that was recognised from UK Active, and obviously really proud of that. One of our new machines, the Cross Cycle, and this is a machine that Sara's working with at the moment, we got a 5-star product rating from Able magazine, which is an industry publication that goes out to 50,000 readers within the disabled community. So again, with the R&D work that we've been doing, it's just a sign that we're going in the right direction and the changes that we're making are being accepted and well received. So just looking at the evolution of power-assisted exercise, we use that term. Here at Folkestone, the suite's referred to as a toning suite. If you use the term isokinetic, motorised exercise, CPM, movement therapy, it's all the same thing. It's equipment that plugs into electricity and it's equipment that moves you. So you can actually work passively with it or you can actually put effort in as well. So anybody who presents with, say, fibromyalgia, multiple sclerosis, and they're having a day where they're really, really fatigued, they're still going to get benefit from the machine. They're still going to get the blood circulating around the body just through passive exercise. Obviously, if they're feeling quite energised that day and they want to put effort in, they can put effort in and obviously start seeing some strengthening. You can also work quite fast on the machines and get a good aerobic exercise workout as well. So in terms of its evolution, I'm going to go back to 1936 in America, and at that time there was a real mass polio epidemic going on. And there was a chap called Bernard H. Stauffer, who was a biochemist, and his sister was wheelchair bound with polio, and what he wanted to do was to try and get her moving. So he developed something very similar to this contraption over here that this lovely lady is laying on. It was the first toning table as we know it. Had a little motor in there and it moved your body and you didn't have to put any effort in. Through that innovative design, his sister started to gain some movement, she became independent of the wheelchair and started to get back some mobility. And he thought, hey, we're onto a bit of a winner here. So he set up a store for salon, as he called it, and started seeing people coming in, people living with polio, starting to see really good results. What also happened was there was an influx of ladies coming in. They started seeing really good results. Tummies started to get smaller, bottoms started to get smaller, bulky ankles started to reduce, and they thought, aye, we're on to another winner here. So as time evolved, and certainly by the 1940s, there were an estimated 5 million users, primarily in the ladies' market, using toning salons. Went very well, so what started out as a medical product very quickly became a vanity product, aimed at ladies, marketed at ladies, obviously very financially beneficial for Bernard H. Stauffer and his team. As time evolved and more manufacturers came to the market, we saw a real boom in the 1980s. I know, Heather, we spoke about that earlier today. You couldn't go down a high street without seeing an independent toning salon. It was massive. Again, ladies only, targeting sort of the sort of vanity market, the cosmetic market, if you like. What we also found is ladies working in offices would literally leave their desk, go and do a toning workout, go back to the desk. So it fitted around their lifestyle. They didn't need to wear any special sport wear. They used their everyday clothes and it was absolutely fine. However, sort of early 90s, it started to decline. The high street shops started to close down. And it's one of two reasons. One, the financial climate at that time was dire. So people couldn't afford memberships. There was employment started to decrease. So membership drops, the independent owners couldn't afford to run the businesses, but also leisure centres started to come on the scene offering multiple products and lots of passports to leisures, around the country, offering multiple products at really good price, so the independent salons couldn't compete. So a real lull in the 90s, and then by 2000, early 2000, we've kind of come full circle. We started, us as a Shape Master as a company, started to receive calls from occupational therapists, from physiotherapists, seeing the value of power-assisted exercise with their user groups and their patients, again, putting long-term health conditions. So we've seen a real trend, and for us as a business, that's where our passion lies, and that's, you know, why we're here today. One of the key things that's come out of installations across the country is the social aspect that a toning centre or power-assisted exercise centre brings to the table. And it's widely accepted that users who visit a toning suite go there for the social aspects. We're looking at about 80% of users come here for the social aspect. And just through our observations today, when we first walked through the door at 11 o'clock this morning, we were greeted by two very chatty members who you could tell they weren't putting much effort in, but there was that going on for an hour, and it was great. They come here once a week, they'd like to come more if they could, and just that, and they walked off together, and they were going for a cuppa in the cafe, and it just, it's the same wherever we go, that social vibrance there is so rich, and obviously really good to combat loneliness, and also mental health. So it takes so many boxes. And if you're wondering why these ladies here are dressed in Halloween costumes, that's a centre in Ramsgate, and obviously events throughout the year, this crazy group of ladies come in dressed up, and some of the language is quite colourful too. So some of our service providers that are on our books at the moment, who are seeing really, really good results with those in long-term health conditions. One based in West Berkshire, it's the West Berkshire Therapy Centre. It's a charity model, but they produced an impacts report. On average, they're seeing 250 users a week, and that's pretty phenomenal. Their impact report suggested that 99% of clients strongly agree that visiting the centre had a positive effect on their health and well-being. 95% felt more relaxed, less stressed, and generally felt fitter and stronger. 80% felt that their walking had improved, which is great because that reduces falls. 86% feel that they can cope better with daily tasks, and 80% felt that at least one of their health concerns had reduced. Another centre that's recently opened, Icon Therapy Centre, back end of last year, they now have on average 160 users. I found out today that that's around 200 users now each week, and they're delivering an average of 12 physiotherapy assessments each week as well. So that means a potential user coming in, doing a physical assessment, and then creating a program for them. So their numbers are really, really surging, and that centre is based in Andover. We also have a brain and spinal injury centre in Salford that are seeing 300 plus new stroke users each year. They'd like to take on more because the Hope Hospital, which is just across the road, basically they have 3,000 post-stroke patients exiting each year. They can only accommodate 10%. They don't have the space or the equipment to facilitate that. So they'd like more if they could. And also specialty stroke services in Derbyshire, They're quite new to the table as well. They're bringing in around 100 plus active users each week, and they primarily focused on the stroke population, but they've had to broaden it out a little bit because the demand is proving to be quite popular. Touching on an independent study that the Oklahoma State University did a few years ago, they did a 12-week study on user groups age with an average age of 75. Using the Easy Tone equipment, which is the uprights in the first room that you see there. What they found after that 12 weeks was that 30% had improvements in their mobility, 50% had an increase in upper body strength, 34% improved leg strength, and 33% increase in arm strength. I can get you all these papers as well. I'll pass it on to Tessa to circulate. So.
Excuse me, how long were they exercising for in order to be able to achieve those goals?
I think it was 30 minutes.
It was over
a period of 12 weeks. So from 12 start
weeks.
To finish, over 12
3
weeks.
Months. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So just quickly to finish, just a couple of slides of some of our users. This is on video as well, so we've got the backup to support it. He started at West Berkshire Therapy Centre 3 years ago, and he was falling an average every 2 weeks. Since using the centre, he says that he has a fall once every 6 months, and that really is down to him when he's in a rush. You know, if he's tripping over his slippers when he's thinking, I've got to get my shopping. So that to us is just is gold dust, and it makes our job incredibly rewarding. Rosie's been living with multiple sclerosis for 27 years. It's a key part of her weekly structure, and Rosie says that power-assisted exercise has improved her strength and given her a more positive view of life in general. Shirley, absolute star, she's one of our Margay users. She was diagnosed with fibromyalgia 2 years ago. She started using the centre in April, and at that time she had to reduce her hours at work. She couldn't do her hours, she'd got a small child, she couldn't look after the child properly. Life was really, really difficult for Shirley. Since using the equipment, she says that her life has transformed significantly. And she can now move more. She's also increased the work hours, reduced the medication, and generally feels better. I've kept the last note in because Shirley pulled me up on it, and she says, I've not reduced my medication, I've come off my medication. So incredibly moving, really rewarding for us, and that's my bit. I'm going to hand over to Rachel, who's going to talk through some of the work.
Good evening, everybody. My name's Rachel Young. I'm a neurological physio, so I work with Shape Master, and I'm doing some doctoral study at Sheffield Hallam University as well, because I think all of these anecdotal reports that we're getting about the benefits of power-assisted exercise for different population groups absolutely warrants further investigation, doesn't it? So what we're aiming to build is more of a solid evidence base, so we can really understand the impact of using the machines for different user groups, and sort of start to think about the measurements that might reflect that as well. So that's partly what I'm here to do tonight, is to present some of our early research findings and where we plan to go with that research activity. But before moving on to that, I just wanted to say what a fantastic day we had here. The minute you walk into the venue, the atmosphere was so positive, it was so welcoming. And the expertise and the experience within the team members that we work with today is fantastic. I think you're supporting so many people with really complex and varied needs in a really positive way. So it's just a great venue and a real asset to Folkestone and the area to have that here and the team here as well. So, I mean, the focus of this is on neurological conditions, but really I think a lot of what I'm saying here would apply to other population or diagnostic groups as well. So people who are living with long-term conditions which impact, you know, physical function, impact quality of life, then I think, you know, it goes outside of neurological diagnosis, a lot of the findings that are developing here. I think, again, given some historical context, when I qualified as a physio back in the 90s, we tended to avoid exercise interventions with people who'd had a stroke or had a similar neurological diagnosis. I think there was a belief back then that actually we might reinforce unwanted patterns of spasticity, we might actually make some of the symptoms and signs worse if we started to exercise people, and we had very sort of purist hands-on therapeutic approaches that were very, very popular at that time. A lot's changed since then, so those therapeutic approaches still are central to the management of a lot of people with neurological changes. But in addition to that, I think we're really embracing exercise as a really positive option for most people. And what the research is telling us about exercise for people with neurological changes is that it will improve mobility. People can walk faster, they can walk further, they can walk over less predictable terrain, they can cope with more busy environments. but it will increase strength in the muscles. It will increase aerobic fitness, which again is a big priority, particularly with our stroke population and the risk of recurrence with stroke as well. It will enhance self-confidence and quality of life. People will feel more sure about themselves if they're engaging with exercise. And also it reduces the risk of other conditions or complications developing. So if people are living with life after stroke or living with a condition like MS, if they're still able to engage in exercise, then the secondary complications are less likely to become a problem as well. So that's not research that's specific to power-assisted exercise, but the overall research that's evolved over the last 20 years from exercise being a bit of a no-no for neurological groups to being absolutely something that should be central to the management of most people who are living with neurological changes. But there are some challenges there. So most of those studies have only included people who, for example, can walk independently for at least 10 metres. And I think we know that there's a lot of people who can't achieve that, particularly if they're in the early days following stroke, or if they've got quite a severe impairment from a different neurological condition. So a lot of those people with more moderate or severe levels of physical impairment, they've not been invited into those research studies because they've included things like getting onto cross trainers, treadmills, using things like seated Rodex, where you really need to have a fairly good level of physical mobility. So there's a real challenge there in terms of us finding exercise interventions and options which are accessible for people with more severe levels of physical impairment, and also those who might struggle to access a normal gym environment. Transport's another challenge, and I think we already touched on that earlier tonight as well. So, developing systems with volunteers and buddies to support transportation into facilities is really important. But also just finding the right building with level access, the right atmosphere, the right kind of bathroom facilities is also really important as well. So, whilst a lot of positive things have happened over the last 10 or 20 years, we've still got a way to go, especially when it comes to meeting the needs of people with more complex changes following their neurological diagnosis. So in theory, these are some of the assets or the kind of unique selling points that we might see associated with power-assisted exercise, and why it might be particularly beneficial for people with more complex and particularly neurological changes. So the machines are accessible. You can sort of usually adjust it or gain access to them from a wheelchair. People can take one or two short steps around, and often with fairly minimal assistance, get onto the seat and start to engage in the activity. So they tend to be more accessible than maybe the conventional equipment. And also the way that the toning salons are laid out, they're often in kind of a square shape or a semicircular shape, so you can steer a buggy or a wheelchair through those venues as well. They also help us to initiate movement, so particularly people with Parkinson's disease, people who've maybe got a paralysis down one side following a stroke, initiating movement in those affected areas is a real challenge. So the machines actually help you to get started with the movement. So even if you've got a paralysis, you still get to experience movement in those affected limbs. Often people with a neurological change, they can generate a movement, but they can only repeat it two or three times before the fatigue starts to impair or impede the continuation of that movement. So with the machines, you're actually supported to continue movement. So as the fatigue sets in, you can opt into like a passive mode for a few reps, and then as you recover, you can become more active again and generate more effort again. So you can sustain activity for a lot longer. So the machines here, the default is 5 minutes, and people can, even if it's passive, keep moving for a good 5 minutes.
Does that begin to set up new neural pathways? Even though it's been
yes.
done before you, yeah, it does.
Yes,
yeah,
and I think that's a really good question.
And muscle memory generating as well.
Yeah, so, and I think that's something we really want to explore further, but all of our kind of clinical observations suggest that it does, that you start to recover new movement. So especially we see people start to recover activation in the triceps. People who've maybe never recovered and use of the triceps following the stroke, they find that they can start to initiate strengthening the elbow. So it's about neuroplasticity, isn't it? And I think we are seeing that it can help us to find new neural pathways within the central nervous system and to recover movement in muscles which had previously appeared to be paralysed. Yeah. The movements are either reciprocal or symmetrical, and I think something that's really nice is it isn't all about the affected side. The movements are quite global. You'll have both arms or both legs moving at the same time, and again, I think that feeds really positively into the central nervous system and how it relearns movement as well. You combine limb movement with trunk movement. So in normal movement, everyday activities, if, for example, we're moving from sitting into standing, it involves a really complex set of movements between the back, the abdominals and the lower limbs. And some of the machines replicate those kinds of patterns. So they sort of help us to recover functional movement patterns as well. Something I really like is the fact that quite a few of the machines specifically mobilise around the rib cage and the pelvis, so you get rotation of the trunk and also a lateral flexion of the trunk through a few of the machines. And they're often movements which are really difficult to either handle therapeutically or also to sort of instruct people through. And it means that people get a really nice stretch through the rib cage, which can become a really sort of solid and stiff region. You can opt into interval training options, and some of the newer machines, you get feedback about the symmetry of your effort as well. So you'll see how much effort you're generating through your left side compared to your right side. So again, if people have got asymmetry, that's quite positive for them to try and recover more symmetry in how they're moving. You can adapt it to a different levels of performance, so you can increase the speed, slow down the speed, so that you can look at quite explosive, fast movements, or you can look at quite sustained, slow, controlled movements, so they put different demands on the muscular system. And last but by no means least, it's this sense of positive peer interaction that the centres tend to generate, that you have people who are facing each other, and the camaraderie and the peership which tends to develop in the centres and within the groups is really positive and a massive factor in terms of people coming back week after week and getting those social benefits as well as the physical benefits as well. So we'll go on to talk about a study that we conducted at Sheffield Hallam University, and it's a feasibility study. So when we're looking at developing a research base in relation to an intervention, we really start out by asking the question, is it doable? Is this an intervention that's actually feasible for this group of people? Is it acceptable to them? Is it something that they're likely to engage with and adhere to? So that was our starting point at Sheffield Hallam. It was about inviting some service users with neurological conditions into the university to do a programme of exercise, which was just for 1 month, but in terms of checking out the safety of the equipment, the accessibility of the equipment and acceptability of the equipment for these people with very varied and complex changes, it seemed like a good starter. And as Carissa just mentioned, we're delighted that it's just been published in June this year, so it's in the International Journal of Therapy and Rehabilitation, and we'll circulate the reference for that as well. So it feels like a really positive step that it's out there in print. But the aims of the study was to investigate whether power-assisted exercise was acceptable for people with long-term neurological conditions, and then also to take some sort of supplementary measures of their pre-intervention and post-intervention mobility as well, just to get a feel for other measurable changes in how people move. So it was at Sheffield Hallam University in a little clinical suite that we have within the university. And we recruited people just from convenience sampling. So at this stage, we're not looking at having a really rigorous sample of people. There were people who were known to us, who we could invite in through the services, the neurological services that we worked with them. So they attended 2 sessions per week over 8 weeks. So there was 8 sessions in total. So a short-term study, but enough to just measure its basic acceptability and accessibility. And we looked at also, as well as measuring attendance, we also used a timed up and go test. We had a gait right which measures stride length and stride speed. And then importantly afterwards, we also went out and did some semi-structured interviews with the participants to ask them
what was the first test you did?
Talk, so the timed up and go.
What's that?
So you sit on a chair and about 3 metres away from you, you have a cone. So it's timed from sitting into standing,
walking to
around
the
cone, walking around, and then...
Right, thank you.
So it's a really doable clinical test, but it's really well validated in the literature for these types of populations because it incorporates your ability to sit, stand, turn, negotiate an obstacle, and
it's just timed in order to find out how much fitter they've become.
Yeah, so the speed of it is a real measure for functional performance, and according to some papers, it is a predictor of falls as well. So if you're getting and completing it in less than 12 seconds, you're less likely to fall than if it takes you longer than 12 seconds.
Excuse me, can I just encourage me on figures there? You said that it's 8 sessions of exercise. You said just twice a week over 8 weeks, which surely makes 16.
Or did you say 8 weeks? No, it's 4 weeks. So we had 7 participants. So, I'm not standing here and suggesting this is a multi-centre randomised controlled trial, which is, going to sort of change the course of medical history, but it was a starter and a really accessible starter. So we had 7 participants, and they were a very mixed diagnostic group and also a very mixed demographic group. So we had a couple of younger males who had a history of brain injury. They were both very ataxic in terms of how they moved, so they tended to have really poor balance, poor coordination. They could walk, but it was with a real limitation in terms of the control of their movement. We had 3 older adults with history of stroke, so they all had a one-sided paralysis, and their mobility was typically limited to about 5 to 10 metres, so they all had enough mobility to complete the timed up and go test, but these were people who were wheelchair dependent for longer outings and certainly wouldn't have been included in a lot of the previous studies that have been conducted on the stroke population in relation to exercise. And then our other 2 participants were 2 females with MS. So one wasn't able to complete the timed up and go test because she didn't have sufficient mobility. So her mobility was limited to being able to stand and take 2 steps to transfer around with a lot of supervision as well. The other lady with MS, again, she was ataxic, so it was her balance that was mainly affected, and she could walk probably about 25 metres independently, but tended to experience a lot of fatigue. So there were a really mixed group of people, from young males in their 20s up to older females who were in their 80s, but the camaraderie that developed within that very mixed group was fantastic, so they became great friends. They very much started to look out for each other during the sessions, and even now I see a couple of those service users and participants, and they'll ask after each other, they'll say, how's so-and-so doing? So, that was obviously not something that we measured specifically, but a real positive. So we had 96% attendance, which is really very, very high. That I think there was only 2 planned absences from the sessions, and they were when people had other things on that they knew they wouldn't be able to attend on that day. Other than that, the people turned up. Some were able to manage their own transport there. A couple of people were provided with transport to our university budget. No adverse events happened, so there was no falls, there was no significant reports of any sort of pain or unwanted responses to the machine. So everything went well, everything was safe. Everyone kept turning up, nobody dropped out from the study. So in terms of that baseline feasibility, it feels that that was established within the context of this study. In terms of looking at the physical measurements, so the time took and go, we saw on average that the time taken to complete the test, the average across the group was initially 16.36 seconds, and that dropped by 4 seconds to 12 seconds. To some extent, that might have been a learning effect from repetition of the test, but I think it's likely that some of that improvement in the time was attributable to the exercise that these people had participated in over those weeks. The information or data that came from the gait right, which was looking at stride length and stride speed, was very varied, so there was nothing that was statistically significant that came out of that. But when we sort of looked at the data, it looked like those people who were ataxic, who tend to take very big and controlled steps, their stride length had actually got a bit smaller, which was a good thing really for them, and that the stride length had got a bit more equal. The people with stroke, with the one-sided paralysis, they were tending to take bigger steps, but again slightly more equal steps as well. So nothing that conclusions from in terms of robust evidence, but some indicators that gait was improving.
Sorry, yeah. Can I just ask you about the machines? Were there just 6 machines, or were there 2 dozen machines?
Good question.
4 weeks is a very short time, isn't it, to see such good improvement?
How many
machines were they using?
So 6 machines. So there's
only 6.
Yeah, 4 chairs and 2 tables. So they did. It was basically each circuit was. Their total exercise time was 30 minutes. when you factored in moving between the different machines and managing that circuit.
So it's just 30 minutes over that time. And were they more leg movements and core movements?
Yeah, so they were the newer machines which incorporate upper limb and lower limb movement at the same time.
So both?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
But I think also a few of them found just transferring from one machine to the next almost doubled what would have been their daily activity levels before they'd even actually switch the machine on. You know, and I think that's a factor as well, that moving between the machines, if your ability is really limited, it is exercising itself.
Yeah.
But you know, I think you acknowledge that there could have been a learning effect here, that you know, this wasn't a really controlled study, we can't attribute all of these changes, but they're a trend, and I think that shows us that further investigation can be justified with a larger scale study next time.
Mm.
I think the interviews, and certainly for me, as a sort of the bad part of my head that's a research matter, and now in my older age I'm starting to think actually it's what people think and feel that really actually matters so much, and so those interviews were so valuable and what people were telling us, so we waited about a week for them to kind of settle down, and they were starting to miss the equipment. They were like, well, can you not carry on, can we not just keep coming in, and we don't have a facility at the moment that offers that in the city. But this was some of the feedback that we were getting. So people very much saying, I felt looser. I just felt like I could move more fluidly. That, you know, they felt like the stride length was improving and getting more equal. People felt like they could stand up and transfer more easily. Some of them said, I think because of that effort of getting between the machines, they said, you know, could the machines not just keep going for 7 minutes instead of five? That would be really great. There was a few other sort of unexpected findings. So someone who'd had a sort of frozen shoulder on, so she'd had a stroke that had affected her left side, but she'd been struggling with a frozen shoulder on her right, and she felt that she recovered quite a lot of range and improved symptoms. She was able to start sleeping on her right side again. A couple of sort of more negative feedback. So the person with MS who tended to experience a lot of fatigue, she said that she felt that fatigue probably was worse during the course of the study. And again, that's something we would monitor in future research. She also did have quite a long journey, so she lived the other side of town, so it was a good 30 to 40 minute taxi journey each way for this lady as well. And I think, you know, that could have been a factor. I think something about the locality of the venue is important, isn't it? So we concluded that power-assisted exercise is definitely feasible, it's acceptable, it's accessible, and it's safe for people with complex neurological impairments. So those people who wouldn't have met the criteria for a lot of the other bigger studies that have been conducted were included in our study, and it was fine. They enjoyed it, they received some benefit from it, and they were able to tolerate the machines and access them without too much support or complication. So as a starter, it feels like it very much justifies further research into this area. So where we're going next is I'm going to continue a programme of doctoral study into the area, and starting to look more specifically at the stroke population, and first of all understanding more about the experience and the perceived impact of using the machines following stroke, looking at the Derbyshire Stroke Centre, which Chris just mentioned a few minutes ago, but then to develop that into a more quantified study where we'll look at a case series design where we'll be measuring the blood baseline and then probably a 12-week point following a more defined programme of exercise as well. But using this preliminary data to really decide what outcome measures we want to use, because we want those outcome measures to be meaningful to the stroke population. I think sometimes we as a community can impose measurements on people that don't really matter. Sometimes people don't matter, you know, what we think is important in terms of physical performance isn't always what's a priority to the individuals involved. So the proposed study, we're based at the Derbyshire Stroke Centre. It will be people with a diagnosis of stroke. They will follow a programme of power-assisted exercise, probably for up to 12 weeks, and that will be determined through the earlier qualitative interviews which I'm planning to conduct this summer. And the outcome measures are likely to look at things like physical activity levels. Do people become more physically active as a result of using the machines? But also cardiovascular parameters, looking at overall general mobility and the experience of using the kit as well. So it's just work in progress. We've got a publication, the feasibility of it's been established. I think it's about developing that evidence base so we understand more about the impact of the machines, and they can really help that to be embedded within recommendations and guidelines for different diagnostic populations as well. Are there any other questions or? Yes, yeah.
Have you worked with any people who've got joint hypermobility syndrome?
Not in relation to using the equipment. I think it'd be interesting to look at it.
It'd be very interesting because a lot of the time they can't do the physicality of it, or they may dislocate or whatever, but if they could find a way of building the muscle, it'd be so good for them, because we see a lot of people who've got who are young, you know, who.
We have got some customers that
have you?
I think it, you know, we could theorise that that bilateral and reciprocal activity and the co-contraction that might encourage could be really positive for those groups in terms of improving joint stability and muscle bulk around it.
Yeah.
It just feels like it's starting to scratch the surface of so many different population diagnostic groups, and we're getting all of these anecdotal reports, so it's about building on that, isn't it?
Mm.
Yeah. Good, thank you. I'll hand over to Dr. Sarah Payne, who's going to head up the third presentation this evening. Thank you.
That goes there these days, not here. I'm Sarah Payne. I had a stroke in December 21st, 2009. Just coming up to the birth of my grandchild, and we were in hospital together. In the same hospital. Unfortunately, I was having a stroke, he was being born. I had a headache. I went to bed, asleep in my bed, my partner checked on me. I woke up some 6 weeks later with half my body gone, or not working anymore. Nobody could really explain this to me other than my brain had stopped connecting. Now, I didn't understand this and I couldn't get my head around it, so I kept trying to get out of bed and kept falling over because my body, my left side could no longer hold my right side up. I struggled with this for many, many months. I was lucky enough to get a place in a rehab centre locally before I was then let out home. So I was about 6 months, 6 months in hospital in total.
6 months.
I spent 8 weeks of that in the rehab centre. I was transferred from Tooting to Surrey to, you know, that was all through five or six different hospitals, stroke-wise. Some of that was spent in a coma, certainly the first month or two was spent in a coma. And I really didn't come round from that, I'd say, until two or three years later when I had some kind of mental understanding about what I'd been through. I still didn't understand why my body didn't work. How on earth can you go to sleep and your brain just suddenly forgets how to breathe? My brain forgot how to swallow. I couldn't, and I kept asking my surgeon what I don't understand, and he was, "We don't understand either. But you're alive, and that's good enough." And I was kind of like, "But I've got a young family. I've got a six-year-old daughter who needs to go to school. She doesn't understand. My family are in shock because they were told to go home from the hospital. There wasn't any of me going to survive." So doctors had turned off from me, nurses, health professionals didn't believe that I would survive it, and if I did survive it, I would be a near shadow of myself. I was determined when I came round that I would walk again, and that I would do it on my own. I am, some might say, particularly motivated.
I just remember you in a wheelchair going round and round in circles.
Yes, so I had a wheelchair for a short amount of time, but I didn't have two hands to move it, so therefore my wheelchair only went round in circles, it wouldn't go forwards, and I couldn't progress any further, and I was in a permanent state of confusion, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I was looking for answers all through the internet. I looked at everywhere, I looked at stem cell research, I looked at all sorts of things, and about 5 years later, I think, was when I first saw Shape Monster on the web. I was busy researching like I used to, and poor old Carissa received a phone call that was like, "Help me, just help me. I don't care if I improve or if I don't improve, but I can't keep doing nothing." Because the healthcare professional's best answer to me was, "Well, you're alive." and so you can't make dinner. So what? Let other people do it for you. So you can't walk to the school. So what? My daughter had special needs herself. I had to go to the school for meetings. This was becoming impossible for me to even follow a conversation because I was so exhausted by the time I got to the school after getting a taxi to and from. I couldn't really listen to what was going on for her. Now, she was obviously reacting to the fact that she didn't know whether the mother was going to live or die. She reacted very badly, as I think most 5 or 6 year olds would. And, you know, so in order to interact with the school, I had to get myself back. And I call it determination, some might call it stubborn. I have my PA over here, my darling PA, who puts up with me quite a lot. She also pushes me in the right direction quite a lot.
You don't need much pushing.
No, that's true.
You normally need reins.
But like I say, okay. I say determined, you say...
stubborn.
Well, maybe it's a bit of both, but anyway. But anyway, I got a hold of Carissa. I asked her if I could try the equipment out. She allowed me to try the equipment out, and within a few weeks, I'd say, Carissa, is that right?
Yes, within a few weeks.
Within a few weeks,
we were under pressure to deliver very quickly.
I felt my core muscles much stronger. I could sit up for a longer period of time, whereas before I was really struggling with.
You could stand up straight.
Yeah, that now when I started in the hospital, I was 5'5". I hit 5'5" at 16 and a half, I believe, and I've been that all of my life until after my stroke when I was measured at 5'4". Now, you can take half my body away, but you can't take 2 inches off me. You know, I'll stand for most things, but not 2 inches off my height. And a bigger size on my feet. This was all wow. Yeah, and so all this information that I kept receiving was just, it's not for you. This is best you can. This is the most you're going to get. You have to be grateful for what you have. And I am grateful for being alive. Don't get me wrong. I'm very grateful for being alive. But my life consists of more than breathing in and out, than sitting in a chair, than accepting my lot. I'm sorry, that's not good enough for me. I don't think that's good enough for anybody. And I would rather have tried and failed than not tried and carried on taking. And that was that's what I kept saying to Chris, I have to do something.
Yeah.
I don't care if it works or not at this point. The point is I need to try it. Because the doctors just wanted me to basically...
Well, they
vegetate.
They expected you to just settle with your lot. I mean, when I first came to you as a PA, and you're standing there with your hand like that, your hand was down there and you couldn't move it.
I had a drop.
Shoulder drop.
Subflux, which meant basically my shoulder was out of its joint. Hmm. So I was constantly, my arm was very, very heavy. So I couldn't sort of put it on the side. And most people used to say to me, well, can't you sort of put your arm on the side and butt things up to it, and that would stop them from falling. So it's using it like a second hand. But it was, no, because my shoulder keeps pulling back. It won't allow me to stay there. It still doesn't allow me to stay well. It's better than
it's
it
actually. That's,
but
that's,
you know, I can, I can lift my arm. Mm-hmm. My shoulder does lift up and down. But that's just from
our assisted exercise.
Well, that's really an interesting point, because when we first started collaborating, you were using the dual function chest and legs, so it's the
stair climber.
Yeah. So the shoulder, yeah, pretty much. And you were getting pain, so we stopped that straight away. It wasn't the right machine for you. Sarah's now using the cross cycle, which we showed you earlier from the magazine article. And you seem to have found a lot more.
Backwards foot. I think the up and down movement was too much for me at the time, and it was causing me pain. And much as I did not want to admit any defeat, I have to say that actually this one's not working for me. Although it gives me a lot of improvement in core, like I say, in energy levels, happiness.
Yeah.
Just in happiness, I'd say.
I think just from an observational point of view, when we first met, you were FES, you were an FES device,
Yes.
You walk, your gait was certainly not the gait that we see today.
I had a John Wayne swing.
You did. You did. To put it politely, you did.
I mean, he does it best.
But I think it's so rewarding for us to see you because your posture's improved. You know,
it's taller than you.
All right. Well, everybody's taller than me. I'm a short bottom. it's just so rewarding. But one of the interesting things that I found, well, a few actually from again collaborating, was you mentioned obviously about PTSD. You live with PTSD, and that when you have an episode, that going on the cross cycle really sort of helps you manage that. I found that quite interesting.
I do suffer with a condition called PTSD, which is post-traumatic stress disorder. And basically what that means is that when a normal adrenaline rush happens, mine goes at 100 miles an hour, whereas everybody else's probably you get a little bit of extra adrenaline that helps you think a bit faster and move a bit quicker. Mine will go at an ADHD level. I'm like a hyperactive child that can't sit. Calm down and can't think straight. Whereas actually what I found was with my cross cycle was I could meet my adrenaline rush by working out my own natural adrenaline, which was there, was doing overtime, but by working out I could meet it and slow it down. So instead of doing this big high and then this ultimate drop, which ends in depression, sleep, and not very much else, and pretty much silence for a few days, isn't it?
Dreadful, yeah.
What actually happened was I could meet it. So I could meet it and I could bring my natural adrenaline up to meet my forced adrenaline, if you like, and then the two would level out much easier without being able to have it.
In point of fact, you've had a reduction in tablets for the PTSD.
Yes, most
since definitely. You've been using your cross cycle, haven't you?
Yes, I so don't need
you,
to...
You're down on meds on that one.
I don't need to medically bring them down. Whereas before I was on medication to bring my adrenaline down to a much more normal level, because then you can live at that kind of height, not without doing yourself some serious damage. And like I say, depression, all of those things that follow most life-changing, and I'm sure you know anyone that suffers with any life-changing illness will know that depression comes quite shortly afterwards, and it's a defeatist thing. It's there to defeat you, it's there to keep you down, it's there to stop you from working out the solution, it's there to kick you. Every time you smile, the depression will say to you, you can't do that. You're disabled, remember, you're not a person anymore, you're not important anymore, you can't do that. So you're constantly fighting with your own mind. I had an aneurysm 2 years before I'd had the major stroke. I had the aneurysm in 2007.
Yes,
2007. And it was quite a bleed. It came on very suddenly. But it didn't leave me disabled. I walked out of the hospital in my high heels and my music on, and I was ready to fight the world. I took absolutely no notice of that aneurysm whatsoever. I know now that was a massive precursor and a big warning for what could go wrong in my brain, and that there was a weakness there. I completely ignored it, I carried on with my lifestyle, I carried on with work. In fact, I doubled and tripled my workload. And 2.5-3 years later, I had a massive stroke and my body went, that's enough. I asked my surgeon what it was. He said, you may have a weakness from... You may have been a toddler in the playing ground and fallen off and banged your head, and that could have caused a tiny little weakness that has somehow become obvious in the 42nd year.
Has your consultant actually seen any changes in you since you've been exercising? Has there been any notable changes?
I have to have regular CAT scans, which I'm sure most people that have had a stroke will understand, and that I think about 4 years, four years ago, I had a CAT scan that showed. And it was the first one that I'd seen the results of, so it showed a third of my brain not working, was in complete darkness. And I looked at it and I thought, I don't know how I breathe, never mind, get up and do what I do. It was completely black and I had never seen a visualisation of what was going on in my brain. I recently, about a year ago,
just going from
Just over a year ago, I got another CAT scan, and for the first time again, I looked at the pictures and there is movement. Pathways are being found. Now, the only thing that I am doing is Shape Master. That is the only exercise I'm doing that is reigniting the pathways that, oh, I don't believe those pathways go. I think your brain forgets how to connect them, but I don't believe they go. I believe that you just need to work from them.
What's that muscle
memory? Muscle memory. Yeah. Your muscle memory is always there. You have to remind your brain how to access that memory.
How often do you go?
How often
do you do the Shape Master? Did you, and how often do you continue to do that?
At first I was on it, I'd say once a week. Now I use mine most days, as many days as I possibly can.
For how long?
I do 10 minutes at first to warm my body up, because obviously I'm quite stiff, and I think most people will be quite stiff from that exercise. So I'll do 10 minutes on quite fast, and then I get the natural endorphins that you get from exercise. You get all of the joys of that. You know, you see people come out of the gym, it's like they've had a good old party, almost, because they've got a smile on their face, and the natural endorphins have really helped. So I do that for 10 minutes, and then I just work out as much as I can. I'll do on fast, because that is the power-assisted movement. Then I'll turn my machine down to medium, and so I'm actually actively doing a lot of the work. And believe me, when you change the settings, you can. I made my sons work all taking a bit of the mickey out of the power system. It's not really exciting, mum, is it? Because it's doing it for you, you know. All of this came about, so I'm like, well, you get on then. And I put the machine on to very, very slow, and they're struggling to push it. One of them's a PT trainer, the other one's a tree surgeon, so they're like very, very fit boys. And I stood my laugh and I said, I thought I'm not exercising them. And they went, okay, all right then, we'll let you have that one. And now they come around periodically to give themselves a bit of a...
I think the thing is, you do, on average, 20 to 30 minutes on average. I've known you do 40 minutes. Because
it's not
because you
difficult.
You felt you needed to do it that day, but the following day you only did 10.
Yeah, I try. I'm a bit OCD about certain things, and I do tend. And I think that's partly my brain injury, is that it makes me very, very focused. And because I'm so very focused on exercise, I could quite easily overdo it.
Absolutely.
And you know, Ali has had to come down sometimes and just say to me, right, that's not enough for today, and turn it off, and then, you know, calm down, and the next day we'll only do half of that time or a quarter of that time. And I'll make sure that I do my 10-minute work warm out up, but I don't do the following 10 and then just keep pressing the restart, the restart, the restart. Because it is so easy, it's power assisted. Once I'm tied into the machine, I've strapped my legs down to the foot drop. I've got a magic glove that you can open, you know, I can open my hand out and rip it round the handles on the machine, and then the glove will hold it on with Velcro. So
what
it is
that one?
That's the one. There.
It straps you in place so that you can grip the machine and it holds your hand that wants to let go at times.
And it just comes over like a mitten and it holds my arm on. So, you know, once I'm strapped in, as I say, it sounds like I'm, you know, being Frankensteined or something, but once I'm strapped in, my ankles are down. I mean, it's really helped. I had really bad foot drop, whereas my foot very rarely, I was always on my tiptoe. You know, my heel never touched the floor, because that's what foot drop is, basically. And I would spasm my... Carissa, can you remember when I walked, my leg would just come up and shake, you know, shakes up here. And then you'll get a fall or an imbalance. And all of that, by actually doing that exercise with the foot strapped down, so that I'm strapped with my heel on the stair plate, not the foot plate, really tight, and it stays in that position as my foot goes round and round, so there are, you know, my ankles moving at a,
you've got mobility of your left ankle. You are actually able to sit and stretch and bring it back and forth.
I can at times, I can't do it all the time.
Not all the time,
it's
but
like
you couldn't do
heel
it at all.
On the floor, you know, I can move my foot like this, which is something that had been written off from me. These are the things that the doctors said I would never get back. And it was accepted.
The physiotherapist, said they'd done the best they could.
Yes,
for you.
I had many times interacted with my physical physiotherapist. They kept on down, I would do their 6-week programme and I would religiously stick to their exercise practice. I do get a bit OCD about these things, so you know. I would be there at the bottom of the stairs doing the upper one stair and down one stair and up one stair. And polishing the table. I don't know whether anyone's met the physiotherapy where you have a rag in your hand and you move this on. And then you move this on and you think, oh my god, wax on.
Wax off.
Because that's the exercise that moves the shoulder. And I was thinking, I don't polish tables for a living. I don't think that's my future. Thank you very much. So,
you know, with you.
The physio's had sort of, I'd get to my 6 weeks, as everybody does, and then you hit this plateau where the physio say, well, I have to go to my next patient. You know, we've got a long list and there's a line of people that I have to see. I've done 6 weeks worth with you and I now have to go to the next person and see what improvements I can make with them. Not their fault, it's just time and tide and money and the way the system is. You work within it and you get your hour at a time. I made the most I could of each 6 week limit that I had. My physios had pretty much written me at a level. I had made great improvements. As you can see, I stand without my stick whenever I possibly can. I can walk on a flat surface. I would have no problem walking down this room without worry or fear. I would not do it outside. Mm-hmm. My limitations are that as soon as the floor is a little bit undulatory or you've got gaps, so pavements aren't my friend, I'm afraid, and even when I have my stick, they're still not really mine. So there is no miracle recovery. I'm not suddenly standing here and going to do gymnastics down the... I wish I could, but that's not going to happen. You know, cartwheels may well be a thing of the past. And maybe that's one I will accept. But for the moment, it just keeps getting better, and I do keep getting more and more movement, and I do keep getting things come back to me that I wouldn't have necessarily associated with having exercise, but my vocabulary is better, my speech is better. I can swallow, when I first had the stroke, my swallowing mechanism didn't work at all. I sounded like Mickey Mouse on TV. That's how I, you know, that. And it didn't sound like me, and I couldn't work it out. I worked really hard with the salt team, who taught me to swallow. I often choked on water and tea, and they thickened everything for me in the hospital. They thickened my tea and gave me tea in my left hand. I said, there, hold that, and I'm like, it doesn't work. You just told me it doesn't work. Why are you giving me tea? And I took one, so I was allowed to use my right hand to help my left hand, so I thought, okay, I can do that. So I took a sip of this tea and I sat there for a second and another second, and then I threw it. And it was just, I'll use this hand to do it and I'll throw it. Not bloody drinking that. Who thickens tea? It had been 8 weeks since I'd had a cup of tea and I wanted a proper one. But there you go, now I can. So there aren't miracle cures, but there is improvement, and we'll keep on improving. And I'm still using mine, so please use this whenever you can.
And anyone you know.
And any disability. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work, but at least not going to die trying. She says. Non-disclosure.
Thank you, Sarah, thank you so much. Can I just also add that Sarah has kindly committed herself to do the London to Brighton with us next September to raise money for the Sepsis Trust, so thank you very much, Sarah. I will be doing it too. It's a very personal course. I'm sure you'll get some emails from us nearer the time.
I get to do it too.
I'm riveted.
But just a personal thank you from us at Shapemaster for coming along today, Sarah. And thanks to everybody for visiting us here today, and to Tessa and her team for allowing us to share our information with you. It's been great to meet you all. Thank you very, very much.
And I'm not going to hold you up, but just before you go and try the chairs, because I really want you to go and try the chairs and the tables, and Heather and Debbie are far more experienced at it than I am, so I'm sure they'll help you out and show you how they work, and just encourage your your patients, your clients, your customers, the people you care for, to just come along and try. Mm. We do give a week's free trial, so they can come along and try. It's not going to cost them. We're not expensive. Yeah. Just want to tell you about us a little bit, really, really quickly. Our Sports Centre Trust has been here for just over 50 years. This part, this toning studio, as we call it, the Wellbeing Centre, has actually only been in operation a fraction of that time. And I have to say, when I came here, quite a long time ago, 20-something years ago, I didn't believe in things like this when they bowled up on our doorstep. I honestly didn't, because having always been a sporty person in my youth, to me, if you weren't playing sport or running on a treadmill, you weren't exercising. And then these came, and Debbie, you came with them originally, didn't you? And I didn't believe in them. And then I got older. I was old enough then, but then I got even older. And then the arthritic bone kicked in. And just to give you an example, when I came back to work in January after the couple of weeks Christmas break, now I work right up in the top of the old building next door, and I was literally pulling myself up to my office on the banister. And then I started coming over here with my dear lovely sister. And within a very short space of time, I can walk up those stairs, don't me. I don't put myself up on the banister. And I don't come over here as often as I should because work gets in the way, but I do come over here. And now I'm sold, because I can't run on the treadmill anymore. I can't play badminton anymore, but I can move because I use these. And I really, really want to say to you, whatever you believe, whether it's just for the well-being side, to come out of social isolation, or whether it's to
come and have a cup
get
of coffee.
You moving, come and have a go. Because I tell you what, it's hysterical sometimes. And we have had ladies, widows, come in here, and they say, you saved my life. Because I didn't know anybody after my husband died.
Yeah.
And they come here, and they go over to the cafe next door, and that is their social life. And I will quote dear darling Rita, her husband died, she knew nobody, she sat on those chairs, and she cried when certain music came on. And in the end, in a very short space of time actually, she was laughing and as disgusting as the rest of the ladies on those chairs. She then started volunteering at the hospital and she said, you saved my life.
That's lovely.
And that's why we do what we do.
Yeah.
We are, just to go back again, we've been here just over 50 years. We are actually a charity. We, as our charity that was formed by a couple of businessmen all those years ago in the 60s, they formed it as a charity. We are still a charity. We are not local authority owned. We are not funded. What comes through this door is what keeps us going, and we're really good at it.
What's funding?
Sorry. What's funding? I don't know what you mean when you say about who's your funder. So it's really important that people use it, and it's the old thing, use it or lose it. But actually, we are so passionate about what we do, because it's not just about sport. Yes, it is about sport as well, and that's why it was formed, but we house the Disabled Hub for the KCC, the Learning Disability Hub. We have a sensory room. We do so much for disability and disadvantage. This changes people's lives, and I really do encourage you to send them along, book in with Debbie and Heather, have your 3 weeks trial. It won't work for everybody, I can promise you that, but it will work for 99% of them.
Yeah.
So please come along and try it. Go and try it now. I won't let you out.